Good morning. Oh, I'm so glad to be back home again. Yes. As a matter of fact, this last trip, I've been away for about 3 weeks. I was in Seattle, I was in Burbank, I was in Chico, I was in Sacramento, I was in Burbank, I was in Santa Monica. Then I was in Charlotte, North Carolina, and then I was in Chicago. So there you go. And I'll tell you, the more I travel around as I do, the more I recognize and realize that there is something huge that's going on in the world today. There's something that's happening. There's something that is growing and evolving. And we see it in so many different ways. There's an idea that's out there that is being put forward of dissatisfaction. And that dissatisfaction is not a negative thing, it's actually a very positive thing, because what it does is it spurs a change and it spurs something different happening in the world today. So what we're going to do today is we're going to talk about a few things, and we talk about our vision for a new world, or as it was titled, A Brave New World. And the title, some of you probably realize, a book was written once called by Aldous Huxley called A Brave New World. And it was somewhat of a parody on the lifestyle of the 1920s. This talk isn't going to be a parody. Actually, Huxley, though, he took it originally from Shakespeare, from a play from The Tempest. And in The Tempest, what happened was that there's this young woman who spent her entire life living on an island. And finally, when she's discovered, she comes off of the island and she gets to view and recognize and see all of the humanity that she's never known before. Her name was Miranda. And she steps forward and she sees it. And one of the lines in The Tempest, and I paraphrase, I am not a Shakespearean actor, but what she says basically is, oh, wonder of wonders, what a magnificent scene this is to see all of humanity like this before me. Oh, brave new world that has humans such as these. Now, you know, that's pretty good, but you have to understand that the people she was looking at were a pile of drunken English sailors back in Shakespeare's time, and that's what she was viewing and that was what she was witnessing. And I believe to a large extent that some of those drunken English sailors from the 15th century are still hanging around with us today. They're still doing their thing and moving forward, and they're still acting in the same way as they acted back in the 15th century. That's, once again, not a negative thing. It's a thing that's time has come to change. The time has arisen for us now to be able to step into a brave new world, which means step into a brave new culture and a brave new consciousness, a brave new idea, to be able to bring into the world that which is required in order for it to work in congruence with what it is that we desire and know to be true. You know, we see it. We see this change happening so many different ways. You know, right now, as we stand here, as I stand here and speak, we can see it in the Occupy Wall Street movement. We certainly can see it in how it's reached out into different countries, whether we're talking about Libya or Egypt, or whether we're talking about Tunisia. The introduction of this thing called the internet has allowed and opened us up to be able to communicate and recognize and know exactly what we teach here, which is that we are one. And it looks peculiar when you see it in different cultures, in different areas, in different lifestyles. It's sometimes a challenge for us to really sink our teeth into it. But without a question or without a doubt, the world is changing. And I hate to come up here and scare anyone, because fear is not the method or the motion that I want to do here, but I will tell you is the world is changing. It's going to change whether we're in agreement with it or not. It's already happening out there. And it doesn't really matter how it comes about or what occurs with it. What matters is that that evolution, that consciousness, that culture is beginning to change. It's beginning to open up to the possibilities and the potentials that Erin Joyelle spoke about in her beautiful treatment. The possibility and the potential that we have enough in our life, we have enough in the world, that what we can do is we can deliver and have an equality in life, not just in Canada or North America or the Western world, but in the world at large. And it, like I say, it's already occurring and it's already happening. In my lifetime, and we can even go to probably the last 20 years, we see the evolution and the coming forward of China and India and the rest of the third world as they step into this world of receipt of the material goods. And they bring themselves forward to play at a world table. And we see, like I said, in Tunisia and in Libya and in Egypt and even now in Syria as I speak, we see it beginning to come forward where people are beginning to step up to the plate and participate in a way that is transforming and changing the way that we view the world. And it creates a huge demand on our world, which is a requirement because this world is ready and willing to step into it. The only thing that keeps us from being able to move into this greater idea and this grander idea, the only thing is our unwillingness to let go of the things that appear to be working so well in our life. As many of you know, I was a participant and helped bring together two religious organizations. And several years ago, I was in Kansas City, Missouri, speaking. And at that particular time, I was speaking to a group of ministers from the other organization. And I can recall when I was there, I was talking about how necessary it is for this to take place so that we can take the next step in the evolution and go from the competitive society we have today to a creative society, to move in that step of consciousness where we stop trying to compete our way into success and we start instead working creatively with each other in order to manifest and bring into the world something that's different. And that really is what's happening for us, is that when we move that competitive urge away from ourselves, when we finally come to realize and embrace that concept that we hold already, that there is only God and that is the outpicturing of the world and that it requires nothing but the abundance of that life itself in order to manifest itself into the world around us. When we awaken to that, recognize that, realize that, it gives us the opportunity to be able to step into a different world and a different way of doing things. And up until now, what we've been doing is we've been holding on like grim death to some old ideas and some old things that we don't want to let go of. We don't want to surrender and let go. And the end result is that we get to have those things repeated to us over and over and over and over and over again, whether they're working or whether they're not working. So that it's possible for us to actually change our mind as a society and move into a place in this world where it does work for everyone. And it comes not just from awakening humanity to its spiritual magnificence, but it comes from awakening humanity to the potential and the possibility that there is a different way that is possible to live. And that the power that has brought us this far in this world, in this universe, in this life, on this plane, can take us the rest of the way if we're prepared to surrender ourselves and surrender our prejudices that we hold on to around certain things that exist in our life, and so that we can move forward. So when I was speaking in Kansas City, I recall I was talking about the integration and I was prompting and promoting and selling the idea of integration to the other organization. And I recall quite clearly that it came to me when I was giving the speech that I had no intention of being the one that was going to make it happen or even participating in it. And I actually thought about it a little bit and I blurted out, as I'm not unknown to do, the truth of the matter, which is I never dreamt that I would have been standing in Kansas City, Missouri, speaking to 600 ministers and telling them about how we're going to integrate two organizations, of which to a large degree, a large number of them in that room had no idea was about to happen. And I said to them, you know, I always envisioned that it would happen. I knew it would happen. I had the sense it would happen. I felt it would happen. I just didn't know that I was going to be part of it because I wasn't prepared to do the work and let go of what I needed to let go of in order to make it happen. So I used the analogy of I always thought that some angels were going to drift down from heaven.